I would like to introduce David Norton, who, as I mentioned, a patron had suggested we invite Mr. Norton to speak on what he has spent many years putting together. We will see a new aspect of King Philip's War by looking at these historic locations, the sites throughout New England. So I welcome David Norton to the New England Library.
Okay, my name is Dave Norton. I'm a retired engineer, but I'm also a member of the Seekonk Historical Commission, very much interested in history. My daughter's a fifth grade teacher in Plano, Massachusetts. And in Massachusetts, the curriculum is, one of the curriculum, part of the curriculum is King Philip's War. So she asked me to sort of, since I had nothing to do and I was retired, sort of go around, take some pictures or whatever, or put something together, and it developed into my primary interest. So we'll begin with the show. We'll have questions at the end of it. But we're going to begin here. I've traveled all over New England, taken all up to 44 different sites, King Philip's War, put it all together on a slideshow. And the kids, like in school, really like it because it's very visual, and they can really relate to it rather than just reading a textbook or listening to a lecture. So to begin with, King Philip's War started in 1675 and lasted 14 months and ended in 1676. This place here actually is a cemetery of some of the soldiers that were killed in King Philip's War. This is on the North Attleboro-Plainville line. So to begin with, over here in East Providence, of course, we have Roger Williams, first settler in Rhode Island. That's actually right down the street at East Providence, and that's his well, where he came over here and settled in Rhode Island. And he was very friendly with Massasoit, and they had a great friendship back in the day. And now we're getting into Massasoit, who was the head of the Wampanoags. And this is on in Warren, Rhode Island, on Baker Street. And that's the site of another well. It's Massasoit Spring. And of course, any of the Native American villages or whatever, it's always centered around where there's a spring. And this has all been dried up, of course, but that's quite a nice mark here if you happen to travel down to Warren. Now, across from Swansea Golf Club, a lot of people go by this. I went by this for years, never knew what it was. And it's called King's Rock. And what it is, if you take a look, there's a basin right here. There's a rock here. And going way back, Massasoit's time, they used it to grind corn, to make cornmeal. What they would do is put all the corn in here, probably take out this rock here, probably get a long lever here, push it over and grind it, and push it back again. So it's one of the first energy efficient type of operations. No, it's not gas powered or electric powered. It's quite a relic here. A lot of people really don't know exactly what that is. And what I might want to tell you is that the handouts I had, I categorized that together by town, but this presentation here is going to be in chronological order of King Philip's War, so you get a better appreciation of it. So to begin with over here, this is in Halifax, Massachusetts, and Massasoit had two sons, Metacomet, and he also had Wamsutta. And so when Massasoit died, the head of the Wampanoags became Wamsutta. But there was a lot of problems in the area between the colonists and the Wampanoags. So what happened was Major Winslow of the colonial militia wanted to get a hold of Wamsutta, get together, create some kind of a peace treaty, something going to stop all the problems that they had. But Wamsutta was very reluctant to do that, so they captured him here. This site here with a plaque here in Halifax, and they took him to Plymouth. And during his captivity, if you will, in Plymouth, they fed him whatever, and he became deathly sick. And there's two sides of the story. Some say it was intentionally poisoned, and others say it was strictly a matter of food poisoning, and he was very ill. In any event, he died, and now the head of the Wampanoags became Metacomet, as we know today, of course, as King Philip. And of course, there's no pictures back then, but this is supposed to be a pretty good sketch of King Philip. So now he was the head of the Wampanoags. Now, if you go to Bristol, Rhode Island, this was a very sacred place here, King Philip's chair. And it's really great. It's owned property owned by Brown University. And make sure if you go there, you get a knock on the door and get a pass. Then it's fine. You can take a look at that. But you go up this nice trail right here, and there's this large, large rock right here. I'll show you that on the next slide. And that's King Philip's chair. I always try to put a person in here to get a relative perspective of that's my wife right here, and the chair is right here. Actually, if you sit right in it right here, it's amazing. You fit in it, it just fits in really good. And that's where King Philip would have all the braves would be right here. And he would sit there in the chair, and of course it's all overgrown back here. But you could, if it wasn't overgrown, you could actually go and see the Mount Hope Bay. That's quite a place. Now, tensions are really rising here. And this is over in Middleborough. And there was a elderly Wampanoag by the name of in Middleborough, anyway, he graduated from Harvard, he could speak English. So he's the go-between, his name was Sassamon. He was the go-between between the colonists and the Wampanoags. And for some reason, he told the colonists that there might be a potential uprising. Well, the Wampanoags found out about it, and they had three braves over here at the Assawamset Pond. And what they did was, in the dead of winter here, the three Wampanoag braves captured him and killed him and buried him under the ice. Now, there was another Wampanoag that saw this situation, and he reported that to the colonists. So they captured the three Wampanoags, and they had an impromptu trial, and they hung them all. So now, it really, tempers are starting to flare, and it's starting to get into this whole atmosphere of King Philip's War. So I went to the Historical Society, and I said, yeah, I'd like to know exactly where that was, and they showed me how to get it behind a school in Middleborough, Lakeville. And that's exactly where it was. There's Assawamset Pond. I took it from the shoreline right here, and supposedly, according to historians, that's exactly where that incident occurred, with one of those things that really precipitated King Philip's War. I went out to try to find out some of the sites here. And in Sharon, Massachusetts, this is King Philip's, one of his camps. This is great. I mean, if you have kids and it's the summertime, it's well marked, you got paths, you go out, walk through the woods, you go through over creeks, small footbridges and everything else. It's a great place. And that's where one of the places where King Philip had his camp. And what I did was, I went here and I had my digital camera, and that's my son-in-law up there, and that's my grandson. And he told his grandson, stay next to your papa. So he was right next to me, and I'm taking the picture like that, but he is quick. And I took the picture, boom, there he was, right on top of the rock. So that's kind of a neat picture. Now, another trail you could take in Sharon, it takes you around, it goes on another trail, it's called King Philip's Cave. And actually, you can walk down here, and underneath here is a cave. And if you have problems with snakes and mice and who knows what else is in there, you're welcome to go in it. I was just happy to take the picture. I think everybody knows where this is. Now we're back in Rumford, which is the Ring of the Great, as we all know it. And that's a monument right there. And that's to Reverend Newman, by the first settlement over in Rumford. And Samuel Newman, and the actually first settlement, his son Noah Newman was involved in King Philip's War. And that's their gravesite right here. And I wanted to show you this here. This is the picture I got of the Ring of the Green. Very, very interesting. What you have, all these different plots of land. Of course, they built all the houses back in 1675. The home lots that were home with planters, all the way around here. And what they had in are these, in the red, I put the garrison houses. Okay, there's one down here in the corner. And the whole idea here was, if they were attacked, any of these folks over here were attacked by, in that particular area would be the Narragansetts, all the families would leave their houses and go into a fortified garrison house. And that's what they were here. Also, for protection, in the center, this is the Ring of the Green, during the evening, you could see there's a gate here, a gate here, another gate, all these gates. They would shut these gates at night. And the reason they did that is they would put all their livestock, cows and sheep or whatever, inside here for two objects here, to protect against the wolves and the coyotes. And I guess we still have coyotes today. But that was a big problem. That was their livelihood right there. They shut all the gates there and they protected themselves. And also it was a form of protection here if they ever got attacked. Now I took a look at all these family names here. Reed and Leonard, Sabin. These are all names. A lot of these, if you take a look, there are streets all around here in East Providence and Seacock, where I live. A lot of these are all Carpenter, Newman. It's really quite a layout here. Back in 1675. Now, the first battle of the war was in Swansea, Massachusetts. The Miles Garrison House, and what happened was the. There was a dispute, and the Wampanoags decided to start going house to house, burning houses or whatever. And so all the people got into the garrison house. The garrison house, they fortified the house, that's where you would go. You know, go into the garrison house for protection. And that's the site right here of the Miles Garrison. Now, the reason it was considered the first battle, everything else was skirmishes, basically one-on-one. This was the first battle. Because they were really afraid that they were going to get overrun. So they put out the call for help, and they had 200 militia from Plymouth County come over and try to put down the uprising. They did, and 11 militia soldiers were actually killed during the first battle. And their names are inscribed right here. And that's in Swansea, it's right off Route 6. Now, what I wanted to do was, another book came out recently, and the book lists all the soldiers that were militias in the state of Massachusetts. And if you folks are involved in genealogy, this is solid gold. I didn't realize that, but my daughter does all the genealogical research, and I got four soldiers that fought King Philip's War back in my family. And they also said, wait a minute, I'm going to do some cross-referencing here. So I took that with the family names of those on the Ring of the Green. And we'll go through some of these sites as we do to find out those folks actually participated in a lot of these sites that King Philip's War. You can see Robert Smith, Israel Smith, John Miller, Joseph Smith. They were all families on the Ring of the Green. So they were there in the first battle of King Philip's War. So that's kind of an exciting piece of research to develop. And I put this map together, King Philip's War, and all the red dots show you all the sites I visited myself. Over in Rhode Island, Connecticut, Massachusetts, I actually went to Great Barrington. Just to take pictures to see exactly what they look like today. And you can see it really spread out all over New England. So now the war is officially on, and this is actually in Barrington, Rhode Island. This is the first ever Baptist church in the state of Massachusetts. And the Wampanoags set fire to it and burnt it to the ground. And that's a monument there. It's kind of on the way a little bit past Four Towns Farm when you go out there. That's where that site is right here. And they've got all the members of the original church right here. And this is a very sacred place. This is called Council Oak, and this is in Dighton, Massachusetts. What a place to find. A lot of these are adventures in themselves, trying to find these. Even a lot of local people don't know where they are. My wife went with me on several of these tours, and she said, I'm not going to go on any more. We should stop at a gas station, we talk at historical societies, we did everything like that. So what I did, I kept notes of where all to find all these places here. It makes it a lot easier. But anyway, this is our Council Oak, and it's really up on a hill. This is up on a hill over here in Dighton. And that's where King Philip had all his warriors. They would just fill this field right here, and he would have all his council meetings here. There's a nice plaque here dedicated to him, and that's an incredible tree. That was actually tested, and it's over 500 years old. Of course, even King Philip's War goes back 350 years. It's 500 years old, and that's the, I think I took that about 5 years ago. And that's the last picture you're going to see of it as it is here. But it's interesting, it's 16 feet circumference around here. And it lasted through all the hurricanes and everything else. And it's quite a, there's something about the place, I don't know. When you walk up there like that, there's a certain feeling you get, it's just overwhelming. So we'll go to the next slide. And unfortunately, that's all left. The large branch is gone. So I was lucky to take a picture of that while it was still intact. And that probably almost looked the site like it did back in the day. I try to take these pictures where I can limit on the telephone lines and streets and cars or whatever to sort of give you an idea what it was like back in the day. Now I went out and I found this. There's not too much left of some of the actual housing sites, King Philip's War. But this is Russell Garrison. This is in Dartmouth, Massachusetts. Nice plaque here. They do a nice job of mowing in front of it, but they neglected all of this. So if you take a look here, you know, and like I said, I'm a retired engineer, very inquisitive. I said, well, gee, what's up back of that? So I just did some exploring. And there's the actual foundation I found, if you want to venture through that, of one of the garrison houses. And Wampanoags attacked Dartmouth, and they burnt to the ground 30 homes of the colonists. Beginning of King Philip's War. Now we have another story, Edward Bobbitt, okay? Now Edward, he lived in the Taunton-Dighton area, okay? And he had a wife, and he had nine dogs. Children. And he notices he's being followed by Wampanoag warriors. So to evade them, it's the summertime, he climbs up to the top of the tree. And I always ask this question, how do you think the Wampanoags found them? Is there any question? I'll ask the audience here. Yeah. He was at the top of the tree, well hidden. The dog's at the bottom of the tree barking. So he would come down. So they shot him, and he fell out of the tree. Back then, they would bury you wherever you were killed. So this monument is in Dayton on somebody's front lawn. But he was the first civilian to be killed during the King Philip's War from Taunton. Then I did some more research, and I found out in the Old Colony Museum in Taunton, they had his original gravestone. I can't believe this. Someone had found it for years, scattered on the side of in a field, turned it into the Historical Society, and now it's at the Old Colony Museum in Taunton. And there it is. See, it says Bobbin on there, Edward 1670. I got special permission to take this picture and turn the flash off and everything else, but they let me do it. I was very fortunate to have that happen. But you could see it when you go there. Now, we're going back out to Halifax, and John Thompson. Now, he had another garrison down in Middleborough. And this is the monument. This used to be his house on this site. And his house was burnt down. And according to history books, this is actually the hearthstone of his fireplace. So he put it up like this, and they put the monument here to John Thompson. And he was very famous in King Philip's War. So once again, I went to some historical, John Milburn Historical Society. I said, I've heard something. I said, there's something called Hand Rock. Where could I find that? I said, the kids in the fifth grade would be really interested in that. Well, it's on private property. I said, okay. Where was the original garrison house? They said, well, it was on the, what is now a baseball field in Middleborough. And he said, but since you're from the Seacock Historical Commission, I know the owner, that's where he lives here, and the owner might let you go and photograph Hand Rock. So it was a slow Sunday afternoon, I called him up, and the owner said, yeah, my wife and I are home on Sunday, can you be here? I said, I'll be here in 30 minutes. Can't pass this up. The Maskew River runs here. Now, the distance between this garrison and this house is a half a mile, okay? And you say, why is that important? Well, there was a rock right here, in rock, and one of the Wampanoag warriors stood on top of that rock day and night, and he was just yelling all kinds of things just to disturb all those that were basically in the garrison right here. So John Thompson said, basically, I really had, nobody could sleep around here. We're listening to all this racket. He said, I have a long gun, and this rifle is 7.5 feet long. Okay? And he said, who's the best shooter? Well, the best shooter was Isaac Howland. And of course, his father came over on the Mayflower. He's the one that was washed overboard, and they saved him in the Atlantic Ocean. That's another piece of history that I found out. But anyway, who's the best shot? So Thompson said, I just want to send a warning shot out here. We haven't been doing anything here. Maybe we can scare them off, and maybe that'll be the end of this whole thing. Well, anyway, it's a smooth bore rifle, or musket, not a rifle. Rifle, of course, has got, on the inside, it's all grooved out so the bullet twists. Much more accurate. This is a smooth bore. So it's a half a mile away. He takes one shot, and he hits the Wampanoag and kills him instantly, knocks him off the rock. Now today, that is the longest shot ever with a smooth bore rifle. It stands up to the day. And there I am in this fellow's backyard. We got along great. I'm a retired mechanical engineer. He's a retired electrical engineer. I guess we hit it off pretty good. But anyway, I got my hand on the hand on this, where what the Wampanoags did. They took his right hand and they actually traced it and hollowed it out on the rock. It's called Hand Rock, and that's right there. So that's in his backyard. And I think on the next one here, if you take a look at it, you might be able to see the hand. You can see the thumbs. Mm-hmm. It's still there. But it's on private property, so that's a memorial to that Wampanoag grave. And there's the rifle. And I got special permission to take that photograph. You can see that, it's a ton. That's that's taller than any NBA player. I mean, how do you load that, right? But I guess the family donated it, so if you go to the old colony, you can see that rifle. You can also see the gravestone of Edward Bobbitt. Now we move out west, and of course out west, we think of, okay, Arizona, California. Not back then. Out west was in western Massachusetts. That was it. No one else ventured further than that. And this is a fellow by Captain Wheeler. Now we're into the Nipmucks, were the prevalent Native Americans back there. And they were on the warpath. So Captain Wheeler, he had 9 of his scouts with him. And what he wanted to do is to go out into the meadows over here, out in, around Deerfield, and just have a peace talk with him. Look, let's work something out. You know, we want to work together like that. So he gets out in the middle of the field, there was no one there. So he said, well, let's go a little bit further. Then he found out it was completely surrounded, and they killed everyone except 2. And he made it back to Brookfield. So that monument to him was way out in the woods in Deerfield, Brookfield area out in western Massachusetts. So I went out there and I took a look at the field. And here it is. There's this hill going way up here. And you can imagine this now. They burnt all the homes over there in Brookfield. And the colonists all got in this garrison, which is right around here. And they were surrounded in there. So 80 colonists were jammed into this small garrison house. And right here is a well and a part of the wall, which I found out in the woods in this field here, where the garrison house was. And so for day and night, they had the people all trapped inside there. And that's a famous sketch there. What they tried to do is, there were 80 of them, some of the colonists, unfortunately the well was outside. So some of the colonists would go out here to get the water and they would get shot or get hit with arrows. And it was an awful situation. So the siege lasted for 3 solid days. And what the Nipmucks did, they're on top of the hill, and they lit the arrows. So they had flaming arrows, and they shot it up on the roof of the house. So what the settlers did inside the house, every few feet they cut holes in the roof. And during these attacks, they would go through the hole like that and pull the arrows out and snuff out the flame. That's how they had to survive. So the Nipmucks said, well, gee, this isn't working too good. So they took a wagon on top of the hill, and they filled it with all kinds of flammable straw, hay, everything else, lit the whole thing on fire, sent it crashing down the hill, and as soon as it hit that house, all the heavens opened up with a huge downpour and put everything out. But this well is very close to where the foundation is. And there's my daughter. She goes with me on a lot of these visits. She's standing on where the well is. There's a monument here. That's part of the foundation of the garrison house. And that's right there where that cart came down and crashed right into the house. And at the same time, I did research in that book on Massachusetts, which is really interesting. One of my ancestors was a soldier in that area. I can't really say if he was in the house or not. They don't really say that. And another one came up from Connecticut and with a cavalry and saved the day. So we actually had a family connection that I never knew about. Brookfield Siege, once again. I keep this in mind. A lot of people think, you know, the Ring of the Green, the people who just stayed there through the whole of King Philip's War. No, they didn't. They were part of militias, and they went out wherever they had to go. Here you go. Thomas Cooper, Thomas Smith, John Norton, that's my relative, and Samuel Cleveland. They were all there. These two from the Ring of the Green at the Brookfield Siege. Now, we get down to what they call the Battle of Bloody Brook, South Deerfield. It was harvest time in October, and they really, I mean, this was the far west, and basically, it was harvest time, they didn't want all the food, they wanted to get all the food, put it in wagons, get it out of there, consolidate their forces, because nobody was really protected there. It is one of the only really two large monuments in Massachusetts here at Brookfield. What happened at Brookfield, okay, they got in the wagons, each wagon, and they came down, I think 26 or 30 wagons, 80 people all together. And they stopped at a rest break. And they made a strategic mistake. All the soldiers that were in the wagons left their muskets in the wagons, went out, they saw there were all these wild grapes. So they were gathering all these wild grapes. Remember, there's a force of about 80 here. And what happened was the Nipmucks completely surrounded them and massacred of the 80. They massacred 60 of them died. And they called the brook the Bloody Brook. So I did some research there, and there's the brook right there. So you can see the war is really, really heating up now. Once again, a bloody brook. Here you go. A couple people from the Ring of the Green. Samuel Stevens, he was killed there. John Palmer, he survived. Thomas Smith was killed. Somehow, if you put the names and the people together, I don't know, somehow it makes it more real. Okay, now we have Benjamin Church. He said, look, he's going to change tactics. Original tactics was if you had an attack on your town, everybody would leave your house, go into a garrison house, and fight them off, and that was the end of it. But instead, they got tired of burning all the homes down. So Benjamin Church come up with the idea that, no, we're going to send out some parties to scout around and find out where they are, and we're gonna attack them before they attack us. So he changed the tactics because he knew a lot how the Wampanoags, Nipmucks, and Narragansett knew how they operated. So what they did is the Narragansetts they were concerned about, and this is in Workford, Rhode Island, called Smith Castle. So there were 1,200 soldiers came together from the Plymouth Colony, Massachusetts Bay Colony. It was the dead of winter in December. They all got together and they stopped here in Wickford, and they were going to attack the Narragansett camp, which is known as the Great Swamp Fight. And of course, you can visit that. That was taken a couple summers ago. And that's the Great Swamp Fight. And there's your monument out in the woods in West Kingston, I believe. And each one of these is to the, they had a group from 500 soldiers from Connecticut under Major Treat. He later became the first governor of the state of Connecticut. And he also had with him over 100 Mohegans fighting with him. And he also had from the Plymouth Bay Colony and Massachusetts Bay Colony, so that's out in the Great Swamp Fight. And that's, that was a really terrible battle. It was in the dead of winter, and of course, a lot of folks know the story there. They set fire to everything, and a lot of women and children and everything got, they all got burnt. Over 600 Narragansetts perished in it, and over, I think, 250 militia died there. And then, from what I read on that, Major Bradford, he's by another one of my ancestors. I'm a Mayflower descendant of William Bradford, but his son, Major Bradford, tried to convince him, look, we came all this way in a foot and a half of snow. Why don't we won the battle. Why don't we stay here? Because all the huts were there at all. They had a big fight over that. And I guess he was shouted down and they burned them all. And the problem with that is the militia lost probably just as many men trying to get out of there, through all the woods, through all the snow, back to Smith Castle. And they died along the way. And what they are is, at Smith Castle, back here in the woods, there's a monument, there's a mass grave right here where those militia soldiers died. Great Swamp Fight. Anybody from the Ring of the Green? Look at this. John Commoner, Daggett, Fitch, Hall, Ide, Kendrick was wounded, Martin, Bowen, Mason Jr., Miller, Perry, Redwood, Sabin, Wilmart, Mann, Fuller, William Bradford Jr. They were all part of this 1,200 force that fought in the Great Swamp Fight. Now we get up to Medfield, Massachusetts. In Medfield, this is called the Peak House. Once again, this is the only battle where the Narragansetts and the Nipmucks joined forces in alliance and attacked. Once again, they burnt down all 30 homes, and this house here was burnt right to the ground. But that's the original foundation. It was rebuilt 2 years later after the war, just like that. And now it's part of the Medfield Historical Commission. And it's the oldest surviving, one of the oldest surviving houses in King Philip's War period. And I always liked that picture. Look at the, they didn't have any snow on that roof. But if you look at that picture, say, well, okay, I got an American flag here, but everything else here, I tried to take it almost like what it looked back in the day. That's a great place. That's only open by appointment on certain weekends. And here's what they call, it's in Simsbury, Connecticut, and King Philip was down there, and they completely burned the entire town down, but the town found out about it and everybody left. So there was nobody killed there. But it said the town was down somewhere in this area here, in Simsbury. And up here, if you look real close there, that's the opening of the cave. And it said that King Philip stood in the cave with his arms crossed, looked out and saw the whole town of Simsbury burnt to the ground. And as I try to get a close-up here of the cave here, and those are actually people there, you can see how that's actually 925 feet high. The Empire State Building is 1,200 feet high, to give you an idea. They don't let people go down here anymore, so I don't know how King Philip got in here. But that was his site. Now, they had a group of enterprising college kids that decided they were going to take cameras and go inside the cave. And they did it. They rappelled down the side here. So this next picture, I didn't take. From inside the cave looking out. And that would be Simsbury, completely burnt to the ground. It took them a year to rebuild that town. And it's amazing because from the history I read, King Philip actually went over and threatened the border of New York State, tried to get the Mohawks to join him in King Philip's war. And the Mohawks are very, very aggressive, okay? This is up in Great Barrington in that area. And most historians agree, if you had the Narragansett, the Nipmunks, the Wampanoags, and if you could get the Mohawks at that time, because all the colonists, all the homes were getting burned, they would have won the war. But the Mohawks wanted nothing to do with it. Now, we get into Central Falls, Captain Pierce's fight. And in Central Falls, Captain Pierce now got some intelligence that there was a raiding party of Narragansetts. They had burnt a lot of homes, and they were in this area of the Blackstone Rivers back here. And what happened here, they got some intelligence. So he got a party of 60 soldiers and 20 friendly Indians from Cape Cod were with them. And they came across, they got across the Blackstone River. And what happened was, it was a terrific tactical trap the Narragansett set for them. They had a few of their braves come in like they were going to attack, and then they would drew like they were getting driven off. But they were very good about this. They withdrew back here, and when Captain Pierce came across on this side of the field right here, with his force of 80 men, they completely surrounded with 700 to 1,000 Narragansetts. And this was called the payback for the Great Swamp Fight. The fight lasted for 2 hours, you can imagine that. Muskets firing, arrows flying, war clubs being used for 2 hours of fighting. You got down to the last 20 men, Captain Pierce was killed, down to the last 20, and then they tried to escape across the Blackstone River. This is the area right here. And that's where the Pierce's fight was. Now, the Narragansetts captured nine of the militia. And they marched the 3 miles north to Cumberland, Rhode Island, which is called Nine Men's Misery. It's out in the area where there used to be a monastery. It's a long walk out there. And you come up a rise there, and that's here. It took all nine of them, and one by one with their war clubs, they killed them over the head, knocked them over the head. And they were all buried under here. So that's a monument. Now, the significance of this monument, a lot of people don't know. This is the oldest monument to veterans in the United States of America. A lot of people don't know that. Because they were, in effect, all the militia soldiers. I think you know where this house is. Slater Park. The Daggett House. Part of the original foundation, I'm not sure where it was one of the houses in a ring and a green, and that was burnt right down to the ground. And it was rebuilt up, and part of the other foundation was added to it. So I'm going to go some of the houses here that give you an idea was involved in King Philip's War. Here's another one, the Walker House. That's in East Providence, North Broadway.
By Massasoit.
Yeah. And that was, you can see that's the original foundation. That was attacked and burnt right to the ground. And then another house was built on top of it. And there's another one on Greenwood Avenue. And that house, I think it's 150 Greenwood Avenue. Look at this, all the brick on the side. It's pretty nice. That house was burnt to the ground. That site now, when I did the research, is the site where Reverend Newman had his first house. That's the site. And that house was put up in 1771 on top of the original foundation. And there's two other houses that I take pictures of, also on Greenwood Avenue. Two other houses that were actually burnt down. Now, we got the Sudbury, Massachusetts. And this was the only battle in King Philip's War where there was quite an alliance of Native Americans here. You had the Narragansetts, the Nipmucks, and the Wampanoag. That's the only battle. And what they did is they completely destroyed the whole town. That's a monument. I found the site right here of the garrison house where everybody was huddled in. Now, the second floor, this is an interesting piece of history. The second floor of these garrison houses, the walls were bricked 4 feet high. A lot of people said, why would you only brick the walls 4 feet high? Well, the idea was that in case, that's where they slept, so they could sleep without having arrows coming through the walls or musket shots coming through the walls. So when they took the whole house, fell apart or whatever like that, they found all the bricks there, 4 feet high all the way around it. Anyway, this one here, they did the same thing. They lit the cart on fire, sent it down the hill, but in this case, it hit a rock, it spilled all over and went out. But that's the actual site right there. There are not many sites at some of these houses. Sudbury fight, you say, Sudbury, Massachusetts, what's that going to do with the Ring of the Green? Look at this. Who fought there? Robert Miller, John Martin, Jacob Leonard, James Smith, Samuel Cooper, Thomas Reed. And they all survived. Now we get out to a place in Princeton, Massachusetts. Okay, this is where the story of Mary Rowlandson. Her husband was a minister, and they had a house, and they had several children, and they knew they were going to be under attack again. So he volunteered to head out to Boston to get help. When he was gone, they surrounded the house and torched the place, and they captured in that area 20 women and children, the Narragansetts. And they took them in captivity in New England in the winter for 3 months. And every night they dragged them through the woods. It's quite a description. They had to sleep on leaves on top of the snow. They had to go across frozen brooks. They never slept in the same site any one night for 3 months. Broke camp, kept on going, broke camp, kept on going. It was an incredible story. But what Mary Rowlandson did was she talked to her captives and said, look, my husband was a minister, we're very well off, whatever like this. Perhaps we can work a deal. Can you set us free? Maybe they can give you provisions, whatever you need to get through the winter. Let's work something out. So they had a meeting here. It's called Redemption Rock. And they had a meeting, and they agreed to it. So after that, all 20 women and children were, it was quite an ordeal. She carried her daughter. Her daughter was shot through the hip. She carried her daughter with her that whole time, and her daughter finally died in her. And she finally survived that. But it was really interesting because a few years later, she wrote everything down that she could remember on her 3 months in captivity. And she put it in a book. And she published it, and it became the first bestseller in the United States history. And it's called The Sovereignty and Goodness of God. They were treated very well, but by the standard, I mean, they're not used to living outdoors like that or whatever like that. In other words, whoever, you know, the Narragansett that captured them, they lived the same as they did, you know. But it was awful. It was quite a harsh winter and a hard setting to go through. So quite a book. I've got that, and I guess it's here in your library too. A lot of it's all introductions or whatever. But when you get into the meat of the book, it's really only 40 pages long. And she goes step by step, day by day. It's really fascinating what they did, you know, how they were cooking with bear grease and how they I mean, it was just fascinating, her description. It's the only one account like that ever written during King Philip's War. And on the side of that rock, they put the whole story in. Called Redemption Rock in Princeton, Massachusetts. Now, we're moving out to Swansea, Massachusetts. This is a site right in back of the Swansea Library. Path going out in the woods there. This is called Abrams Rock. We're getting near the end of the war. Abrams was a Wampanoag. And basically he said, hey, we're not gonna win this, so I'm gonna go back, I'm gonna go over to the colonist side. And you don't say that to King Philip. So King Philip found out where he was hiding out in one of the caves or whatever around here, Abrams Rock. And the Wampanoag surrounded him, pulled him out, and he says, we're gonna give you two choices. He said, either we're gonna kill you right now where you stand, or if you survive three leaps from the top here, you can go free. That's 60 feet, by the way. So he climbs up on the top, jumps over, and he survives. But this time they had to pull him. They had to help him, support him. Climbed all the way up to the top, second time, jumped off, and he survived. He was really badly hurt. Dragged him up again, and he finally died. So that's Abrams Rock. That's my wife and my dog out walking the woods. Now we get up to Norton, Massachusetts, King Philip's cave. Now, at this point now, King Philip is kind of on the run, and this is his cave, which I found in Norton, Massachusetts, off in the side of the road, a little walk in the woods. Quite interesting. Took this from inside the cave. If you take a look, it's all black here. It's all smoke. So he must have had all his campfires and everything here like that. It's kind of fascinating. That's one of his hideouts, if you will. Now we get into West Bridgewater. The Reverend Keith. It's getting near the end of the war. They're trying to capture or kill King Philip. He escaped, but instead they captured his wife and King Philip's 9-year-old son. And the Reverend James Keith held them in this house. And this house is still standing. It was never burnt down in King Philip's War. This is the oldest structure there from King Philip's War in West Bridgewater. Historical Society owns the house. And everyone in the town and surrounded area wanted to kill King Philip's wife and his son. And the Reverend Keith persuaded them, really stuck up for them and persuaded them not to do that. He basically said they shouldn't be punished for the sins of their father. So they saved him, but apparently historians disagree, but apparently King Philip's wife ended up somewhere in Nova Scotia as a servant for a family. And his son was sent on a slave ship down in the Caribbean to harvest sugar cane. And that's really all we know, historians really know about that. But that's quite a house. They did a nice job on that, keeping that in good shape. Now we're getting to the end of the war. King Philip knows that he's going to lose and wants to go back where he's originally from, so he makes his way back to Bristol, Rhode Island. And in Bristol, Rhode Island, they can give you a map. You can find a trail. You come out to this site right here in the Myrie Swamp. And there's a well right here. There's a nice placard right here. Now, what happened was, once again, it's the end of King Philip's War. King Philip had a council meeting, and one of his braves said, why don't we just end the war? Why don't we just surrender? And you don't say that to King Philip. You kill that brave right on the spot.
Oh.
Now, the brave had a brother. His brother found out about it. The brother's name was a Wampanoag by the name of Alderman. Okay? And he was really incensed by this whole thing. He knew Benjamin Church, so he went to Benjamin Church. And he said, look, I know where King Philip camp is. I know all his, everything he does every day. He said, if you want him, I can take you to him. He said, but I don't want a whole group of soldiers with you. Just take a few. That's it. We'll just sneak up on him in the well where he goes every day to get water. So Benjamin Church went through that, waited for him. And King Philip, sure enough, he showed up. All right? And so they had him in the gun sights, and one of Benjamin Church's soldiers pulled out his musket, he cocked it, he fired it, nothing happened. The gunpowder was damp. So Alderman, who's the Wampanoag, said, it's my shot, he killed my brother. So he shot and killed King Philip. And that's the famous painting there that shows you King Philip down, face down in the swamp. There's Alderman, the Wampanoag, who killed him. And there's Benjamin Church. And that's a picture of the, in the area, Myrie Swamp. The actual location, they say, is about 60 feet west of where that well was. That's the approximate location. A older chief, I think he was 62 years old, named Chief Anawan, he took command reluctantly. And Benjamin Church found out that he was at a place, this is called Anawan Rock, in Rehoboth. So Benjamin Church got quite a group of militia. They secretly crept up on the top of this rock here. And on the other side of the rock here was where the Chief Anawan and the Wampanoags were. That's the back side of the rock, right in that area. So they had it completely surrounded. And Anawan said, okay, the war is over. I got a campfire here. Why don't you join me for supper? Really. And they all came down and had supper. That's the supposedly the end of King Philip's War. Now, I went through a war in Rhode Island. On Serpentine Road, there's one of the oldest cemeteries in Rhode Island. A lot of the soldiers that were killed in King Philip's War, well, the stones are all worn out. You can't even see who they are. This fellow here, John Luther, I did, you know, took a look at the date when he was born, so he must have been 14 at the time of King Philip's War, certainly old enough to carry a musket. He was in the war, but he lived until 1692 or something like that, so he lived a lot longer than these other soldiers here, so his name is actually right here. That's the only one I could really identify. John Miles, we talked about Miles Garrison, the first battle in Swansea. This is his stone. He's actually buried at a place called Tyler Point. It's over in the Riverside area, Barrington area. That's another one of the oldest cemeteries in Rhode Island. Benjamin Church. He was originally from over here in Little Compton. He's got an elaborate place here with a plaque here. He's considered the first Army Ranger in U.S. history with his tactics and everything he fought for. And Burrs Hill and Warren, this area here in the early 1900s, used to be a gravel pit. And they ended up digging up a whole Wampanoag burial site. And one of the sites they found was really ornate with all kinds of copper jewelry and all kinds of stuff like that. So historians believe that somewhere in this area, that's probably the burying site of Massasoit and Wamsutta. And we come to a final story here. This is in Warren, Rhode Island. Hugh Cole, he was a settler in Warren, and he became real friends with King Philip. King Philip didn't bother him. He didn't bother him. They got along great. They settled there in Warren, Rhode Island. And so I read that at the story goes that they came up, King Philip said to Hugh Cole, "You've got 20 minutes to get your family out of your house. I'm your friend. They're going to burn it to the ground." So he said, "Thank you very much." He got them all out. They got in like a canoe and went down the river, turned around, and there's the whole house going up in flames. So after the war, Hugh Cole was a sergeant in the militia. He decided, "I'm not going to build my house on the same site. It's probably bad luck." So I built it a mile down the river, and the well that he constructed with his own hands is still there. So I was trying to find it. This is really interesting story. I was going behind a housing complex. I was going behind school. There's a Hugh Cole Road. There's a. I was there with my son-in-law, and everybody's looking at their watch. We're gonna go home now, you know.
Yeah.
And so I had the last chance I had. They were putting in a new bike path, but it was all dirt then. The fellow operating a backhoe, you know, and it was hot in the summer or whatever. He had one of those t-shirts on, and he had his tattoos on, and he was smoking a cigar. My son-in-law said, "There's no way he's going to know anything about King Philip's War." And look, I came all the way this far. I'm going to find it. I'm going to find where it is. Well, I've been all over the place. I can't find it. Nobody knows. So I asked the guy in this, and he said, "Oh yeah, King Philip's War. I know where that site is right now. Follow down the trail. I'm protecting it. No one else is," he said, "but I'm protecting that site." I said, "Thank you very much." So we walked down there, and that's what we saw. Completely overgrown. There was a granite site here, and the front of it was all, looked like it was, must have had at one point a bronze plaque in front of it. All right, so I went to, I'm from Seekonk now, I'm not from Warren, so I sent an email and I said, I'm not a Warren citizen, but I was concerned about this. You're putting in a bike path in over here. I said, right next to this site here, as part of your history, you've got something called the Hugh Cole School or whatever. I said, "Does anybody know about this site? You ought to clear it all up," because I saw 150 years ago, there's a picture in one of the old books, and it showed a nice, almost like they had this whole place all cleared out, nice little patio here with this thing here. I said, And I heard nothing. So 6 months later, I went out with my dog, we're looking at taking a walk again. And still I heard nothing. So like I say, I'm a retired engineer. I like to get results and not just, drop it right there. I like to give people alternatives. But I said, look, I gave them another email and I said, this might be a nice project. There's a lot of poison ivy here, of course, but it might be a nice project for Boy Scouts or somebody else if you don't have the finances to do something with it. Maybe I would even volunteer to help it. Still haven't heard anything. So I'm ready to give a presentation at the Barrington Rotary Club. And if they did do something here, I would hate to go to the Rotary Club there and sort of offer somewhat of a complaint about it. So I'll take one more time, I'll go by them. So I did. And here's your bike trail right here. And there it is. This whole patio one time was there. There's the well that he did by his. Of course, they put the cement thing around it. They're generally with stones and it's circular. That's my daughter. And there's, you can see where there used to be a plaque right here. So then I said, wow, this is amazing what they did. I really owe it to that fellow in the back, to tell you the truth. And that's the last picture you're going to see. There's a part of the curvature of the well. The last picture you're going to see, this whole thing is all boarded up now so people won't fall into it. Of course, for me to take that picture, I had to get rid of empty milk cartons, beer cans, all kinds of cigarette butts and everything else. I mean, it wasn't really kept that well. So now I went back again. There we go. See, they covered the well. So you folks saw the picture, what it looked like inside. probably the last one in history to see it. And they put this whole thing about Hugh Cole. So sometimes if you write an email, people do something eventually. And that's my story.
Yes.